Praise God. And I know you're probably saying, what do you mean, where do I stand? But stick with us and you will get it. Amen. Amen. We just ask everyone if you would begin to just share with your friends, your family, because somebody needs a word today. You know, we are in a pandemic and somebody needs to hear from God. Somebody needs to know that God has not forgotten them. Praise the Lord. Somebody needs to know that every tear that they've cried is not in vain. Glory to God. And most of all, somebody needs to know, where am I with God? Where do I stand with God? Now, we can't tell you where to stand at with God, but we can tell you how to stand with God. Praise God, because how many know that the word of God is right? Hallelujah. The word of God is right now for a right now situation. Glory to God. And so we appreciate God on today, as me and my husband and my lovely daughter, May, and Pastor January, and me, Lady January, we're going to go ahead and get started by opening up in prayer. But I just ask that you would just shift your mind, glory to God, and just really begin to focus on what you need from God. Ask God to open up your ears that you can hear on this evening. Glory to God. Because one thing that I can say, we are now into the fifth month, which is May, and the fifth number in the spiritual realm means grace. Praise God. And we thank God for grace for those of us who have been left here, for those of us who God has had mercy on. Praise God, we are still here. Glory to God. Amen. And so at this time, we're just going to open up in a word of prayer. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we bless you right now, God. We give your name glory and we give your name the honor, oh God. We thank you, God, for another day that was not promised to us, oh God. So we give you praise, oh God. We give you glory, Jesus. Lord, we just ask, oh God, that as we dive into the Bible, into fellowship, into Bible study, God, we just ask that you would have your way, God. Father God, let not flesh glory in thy sight, oh God, but you be glorified, God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. Some of my friends need you. My family members need you, God. They need to know that you hear them, God, that you see them, oh God. And so we're asking, oh God, tonight, God, as the word goes forth, oh God, that you would deliver and set free, God. Deliver from addictions, oh God. Deliver, oh God, from just issues, oh God, that are not explainable, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. We thank you right now for what you're going to do, God. We glorify you and we give you praise. Hallelujah. We give you praise. Hallelujah. We give you praise. Oh God, what a mighty God we serve. Thanks. I tell you, God is mighty. And before we even, well, we're getting ready to go into Bible study. I'm going to turn it over to my daughter, Sister May, Minister May, and let her ask the first question. But again, we're coming from, where do you stand? Amen. And our subtopic is, who's on the Lord's side? Glory to God. And y'all know we sung a song years ago, where do you stand? Who's on the Lord's side? Glory to God. And I want you to know that the January Anderson family, we're on the Lord's side. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So without further ado, I want to introduce the summit to present to others my lovely daughter, Minister May.
Good evening, everybody. So today's topic is, where do you stand? And the theme is, who is on the Lord's side? So the first question is, who do we develop? How do we develop a personal relationship with God?
Yeah.
So some of like the simple answers that we kind of already know is, read the Bible, learn how to pray, fellowship with others who believe in God. So that means our church folks, you know, people who minister. We always look up to our bishops, our pastors, but also the people of God, the people in the church who are doing something.
Thank you, Jesus.
A difference one and share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then also spend time talking to God. So it's one thing to just pray. We can pray a simple prayer, thank God for waking us up and thanking Him for the simple things. But why are we really praying? Because sometimes we pray because we need things to change in our lives.
Right.
But it's something deeper than that. We should be praying to ask God to really speak to us, and to really seek Him so we can grow a higher relationship with Him.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yes, and so your question was, how do we develop a personal relationship with God? And I think, again, what she said is critical, coming from the age of being 18, almost 19, and really people, when they come into church, sometimes they're not really sure, where do we go from here? You know, we thank God the word of God was preached, and we got touched, and there's an altar call. And then we come to God and we lay all our burdens down and we cast all our cares upon God. But Lord, where do we go from here, oh God? How do I now manage my saved life now? How do I even begin to understand what it is to be saved? And I believe that with that being said, is that's why the Bible talks about
not forsaking the assemblies of ourselves together, because we need each other. I need to know your testimony. You need to know my testimony. You need to know that there's going to be days that it's going to seem like you just can't make it through. You're going to need to know that there are some trials and tribulations sometimes that will come and blow your mind. But nevertheless, if we stay prayerful, glory to God, if we stay connected to the house of God, to the people of God, you know, we all need a prayer partner. We all need somebody interceding and praying for us, because that's what's going to help us develop our personal relationship. I can recall being young, and at the tender ages of 18, we always had youth gatherings. All of us as youth people would come to, our young people, excuse me, we would come together. We would meet at different ones' houses, and we would just talk about the goodness of the Lord. We would talk about what we went through at school, but how we overcame it. Hallelujah. And then we would break off and pray for 20 and 30 minutes. And when we got through praying, we would ask one another, well, what was God saying to you? What do you think God was saying to you? And that's how we continued to grow in God. And then when we knew God gave us a good word, we couldn't wait to get to Thursday night. Because Thursday night was considered youth night. And we wanted to testify. Praise God. We wanted to talk about the goodness of Jesus. So with that being said, it's just something to make sure we're available to the house of God. I know right now the coronavirus has us tied to our living room, but we can still be tied to the word of God. Amen. Just Amen. Because we can't go to a building doesn't mean we can't have church, because we are the church. So it will behoove us to get into our word, to know what God is saying. Hook up with somebody that can break the word down to you, or with that would just pray for you. Praise God. And one thing that we don't talk about a lot anymore is the Holy Ghost. Our young people need the Holy Ghost. Amen. The adults need it too. We need the evidence of speaking in tongues, because once you get saved, there's a miracle that takes place. Amen. And a miracle of speaking in tongues as the Spirit gives utterance. Glory to God. You can't make it up. Well, some people probably try to make it up, but you know who you've been endowed with power from on high. Glory to God. Because it's no other but Jesus himself filling us with his gift, which is the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. And so on tonight, we'll be looking at 1 Peter 4:18-19. And the scripture reads, it says, and if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? And you know, and I've read this for over years, you know, and we read some of the same scripture, glory to God. But sometimes you have to ask yourself, Lord, what did you mean by the ungodly and the sinner? Hallelujah. Because we all know that saints is going to heaven. All saints is going to heaven. Now, somebody might not understand that, because I know some saints. Well, then they're not going. We're talking about saints. God knows who the saints are. And so with that being said, where shall the ungodly? Who are the ungodly? Who is the sinner? And we come up to let you know that the ungodly is that backslider, that person who just don't want to have nothing to do with God anymore, because they turn their back on God. So where are they going to appear? And then you have the sinner, the person who just refuses to ask God into their life, that refuses just to become a Christian, become to know God in a better way. And so we wonder and we say, well, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Well, I can tell you now that if your heart's staying right with God, I know that wasn't good grammar, but hey, if it ain't right, it ain't right. You're not going to make it into heaven. So we got to make sure that our heart is right. We got to make sure that we're standing on ground that will not speak glory to God. And amen. We thank God for a pastor joining us. And I know he has a lot that he would like to say regarding this topic. And again, we're talking about where did you stand and who's on the Lord's side.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
We read the scripture already that says that if the righteous scarcely be saved, then where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear?
Mm-hmm.
This pandemic has caused us all to understand what I call the why, about whether or not we need to rely on God. So now that we have learned about the why, we understand that we do need God. Now we've learned how to wash our hands,
right,
and we've learned how to wear face masks in public. You know, the question now is, how do we live for God? How do we pursue our relationship with this same God? And I believe in tonight's lesson, we're going to get closer to answering this, because it's already evident that if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. So where do you stand encompasses and encapsulates ideas such as, what were you doing before the pandemic?
Right, right.
What are you doing now in the pandemic?
Come on.
And what choice will you make regarding your relationship with God after some of this subsides? I mean, there's a scare and a pandemonium put into effect already to make people think there's going to be a resurgence. You know, people are afraid because the current testing is not really up to par. But the bigger question that I want to plant into everyone tonight is really about, what are you going to do after this thing subsides? After we get to a place, if it what they call the flatline atmosphere. And I simply want to say it like this. If you remember the children of Israel, when they had to go through the tempestuous wind and all of the tenacious, disastrous attacks that Pharaoh was putting on them, and they got past it. And the first thing that they did after they got past it was go right back to living the way that they were living before. But the question is for us, will we as a people still cry out to God?
Right.
Will we still show a necessity for having a relationship with God? Yeah. Will we still understand that He is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord thy God who is always with us? And I see people who never said anything about God before talking about Him now online. Mm-hmm. I see people who never really preached online before make the sacrifice to be online to talk to other folks.
Yeah.
But the whole thing is, we understand that praise and worship is not a spectator sport.
Yeah.
So I've come to tell somebody tonight, don't be a spectator any longer. It's time to be a participator.
Yeah.
And just like you see the other people participating, mm-hmm. it's your chance too. Why does the scripture differentiate between the sinner and the ungodly?
Uh-huh.
Because the sinner that's talked about here is one who sins openly because there is no true or genuine relationship with the Lord.
Right.
Whereas the ungodly are people who were saved,
uh-huh.
and now have backslidden into a lifestyle that does not honor God, uh-huh. doesn't honor His way or His will.
Mm-hmm.
So as we look at this tonight, I want everyone to take a closer look mm-hmm. to what I could be doing different.
All right.
Anytime people go into divorce court or they go into counseling sessions for relationship matters, they always have the question, what is it that I can do differently? And that's kind of the angle we're hoping that some people will take tonight. What can you do differently?
Yeah.
Because in Ephesians 4:1, it is Paul who writes to us and says, therefore I, Paul, the prisoner
uh-huh.
in the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation which wherewith you were called.
Yeah.
In other words, the vocation here is this thing a job for you or is it a ministry for you
uh-huh.
in terms of having a relationship with God? When you look at it as a job, you might get tired. You might even give up because there are some people who you go up to them now, they say, well, I used to be in ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand that because once God calls you, how do you turn your back on the one that made you, manufactured you, called you to be blessed, and then called you? Because everybody that was called didn't answer the call because they couldn't hear his voice.
Right.
And then there are many who are called, but only few are going to be chosen. Hallelujah.
Word.
So tonight, I want everyone to look at, what can I do differently? What can I do better? How can I exhort myself in a brand new way to be pleasing in the eyes of God? So the Bible says in Proverbs that when a man's way pleases the Lord, he'll make even your enemies be at peace with you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So you got to figure out where you stand.
Yeah. And I just wanted to piggyback really quick on, you know, what were we doing before the pandemic? What was going on in our lives? And somebody, and some people, they wasn't even thinking about God. You know, they know about God,
right.
but they wasn't thinking about drawing closer to God. They wasn't thinking about going to church or paying their tithes or giving their offering or making themselves available to their pastors or what have you. You know, but now that the pandemic has happened, we've all had time to sit down and just really begin to start thinking, what is life going to be after this, you know? But are we really thinking about our relationships with God? I still see people on social media as we're scrolling through that they're still can't wait to get to the club so they can get that drink or go party with their friends or make up with their ex or go on their vacations and all, et cetera. You know, but where is anybody talking about prayer, you know? And then I see on Facebook, too, that people are talking about God, and they're saying that this has definitely drawn me nearer to God, and that's an awesome thing, and I thank God for it. But is it enough to keep you when this is over? Because that's sometimes how the enemy tricks us up. He only wants us to want to really seek God
Amen.
In bad times.
Amen.
You know, but when everything is going well, we ain't got time for God.
Amen.
But I want to just submit to you tonight that you want to make time for God at all times, whether in good times or in bad times.
Amen.
You want to have a made up mind that, Lord,
right.
I'll live for
that's
you
right.
and Lord, I'll die for you. I'm not going backwards this time,
Amen.
God. But I'm over here to stay until I die. Glory
Amen.
To God. And I just want to encourage you that what does that look like? How do I stay this time? You got to have newness in life. The Bible says, therefore, if any man
Christ, he's a new creature, and you have to understand that you need some new creatures, amen? Not just yourself, but you need new friends. That's what
right.
I mean, that
That's
you got to start hanging out with people that have goals in mind, like you, have kindred spirits that want to get to know God, that's not going back to the club, and that's not going back to the fornicate, that's not going back to the lying, stealing, cheating, whatever you want to call it, praise God. But we want to make sure that we're setting ourselves up to go higher in God, praise God. Things are passed away, and I named those old things, saints. So we don't want to go back to those old things. So now is a better time than now is to start setting you a time to pray every day. Say, Lord, meet me here at 6. Lord, meet me here at 7. Meet me here at 8. And let that be you and God's time together. And the more you begin to practice that, the more you can start seeing your relationship is building and it's being molded. It's just like when a man and a woman meet. You know, how do you
right.
build that relationship?
Right.
I know I'm kind of getting ahead, and
right.
I know
good.
We have you, but it's just the whole point. You call each other.
Right.
You know, you say, oh, I'll call you at this time. Oh, do you want to go meet for this? Or, you know, I want to take you out on a date. Or I want to go buy this person a car. And that's how you begin to mold your relationship with God. Praise the Lord. Did you have something you want to say, May? Or going back to this? Okay.
I want to make a quick point, because everybody's wondering, not only where do I stand, but a lot of people are wondering, you know, we since we understand the why about whether or not we need God, we understand why we need God because we're insufficient. But many people don't understand the how.
Mm-hmm.
There's a how to this that
yeah.
causes you to know that you have to do something different. And that's why I said a moment ago, you know, what is it that you can be doing differently? And I'm going to use David, the sweet psalmist of Israel, King David.
Yes.
When he got in trouble with Bathsheba, and they had a child out of wedlock.
Uh-huh.
And then the child passed away.
Uh-huh.
And while he was waiting to hear the news, David looked afar on
mm-hmm.
to see the people talking about the child who were standing at the door. And he knew that they had some bad news for him regarding his child.
Uh-huh.
And the Bible even says he perceived
uh-huh.
that the child was dead.
Right.
David got up and washed his face and started living again. Now, in this, we have to perceive that we're expected of God to do something different. So let's do this.
Uh-huh.
Everybody shift over 1 foot.
Uh-huh.
We're going to move the table to shift it 1 foot. Just pull the table with you. Perfect. That's what you got to do. You got to shift.
Got to shift.
You have to be ready for the shift,
yes.
And even if you are not ready for the shift, you have to adapt to the shift, because the shift is already happening.
Right.
You got to move.
Got
Amen?
To.
You, you know, and there's an old song that we used to sing down in Louisiana that said, there's a leak in this old building, and I've got to move. My soul
yes.
has got to move.
Yes.
Everything in you has got to move.
Yes.
You have to go ahead and go catch the wave. That's the old Coke commercial used to say.
Uh-huh.
Catch the wave. You got to shift. You got to shift with the winds of God. And that's going to be the requirement here for somebody tonight.
Yes.
Some things that you used to do, you won't be able to do anymore.
Uh-huh.
Some things you used to get away with, you won't be able to get away with anymore.
Uh-huh.
It's just that simple. We're
yes.
coming into a shift.
Yes.
And this is not a bad thing. It's a good thing, because it causes you to get up out of your comfortable zone. You know, some of us are sitting in the comfort zone of life, and we refuse to move. I heard one man say it like this: I'm not doing anything until I have to. I'm not going anywhere until I'm forced to. I'm not changing until I don't have any other choice but to change. Well, the time is now. If he woke you up this morning, this is it.
Hallelujah.
The time is now for the shift. And if you have any amount of intellectualism in your mind, you ought to understand that it is no longer business as usual.
Mm-hmm.
And for people who've been playing with God, you ought to also understand that playtime
mm-hmm.
is over. It is just that simple. It's
yeah.
time for the shift.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So as we get ready to go into our next question, we're going to open up the floor.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're gonna deal with some things here. This next part of our discussion is going to be surrounding the emotions that you now feel as a result of the stay-at-home order. And this question simply says this: how do you view God now during the pandemic as opposed to how you viewed him before? How do you view God now as opposed to how you viewed him before? Who wants to take that challenge? All right, speak loudly.
So at first it was kind of hard to really accept the pandemic and then also really to come to an understanding why the pandemic was going on. But I never thought that it was some type of natural meaning or moral meaning. I thought that it was something spiritual. I just didn't know how to interpret it. And then me and my mom had a Bible study kind of about what the pandemic was and what the Bible says about what's going to happen, how everything in the Bible comes to pass. So finally coming to a realization and an understanding, it made it easier, but it also made it easier in the whole process to talk to God. So,
man.
And during this time being at home and trying to understand why this is happening, I'm able to pray and say, okay, this is happening because God is allowing it to happen. But what does it say in the Bible? That the days, the last of the days are not going to get better and less sin. It's going to get worse and there's going to be more sin. There's going to be more things. This is just the beginning.
Right.
So it's allowed me to kind of grow my relationship with God instead of just generally praying, but asking God, what is the deeper meaning? You know, what is my purpose? What is my calling? What am I supposed to be doing? What assignments am I supposed to be fulfilling in the times that we still have? Because God, for his people who are going to be willing and obedient, he has an assignment set for each one of us. So we have, it's on us to be able to meet God halfway and say, okay, what is my assignment? What am I supposed to be doing? And he'll give you the answer if you seek him. And if you keep praying, you might not get an answer right away because there's still things that I have unanswered prayers on. But if you just be patient with God and figure out what his word says for you and what it means for you in your life, then he will talk back to you. So.
Amen. And I agree. Also, you know, for me, I can answer that question even for me personally. It was just like, God, you're proving yourself.
Amen.
You know, the word is being lived out because we read in the last day, perilous times shall come. We will see famine. We will see pestilence. And he said, we will hear of wars and rumors of wars and, you know, divers, earthquakes, et cetera. But I thank God thanks because I read upon this and I know it. And I know that it's just God proving himself. And,
yeah.
And some may say, well, this is nothing but the devil. We can call it what we want to call it. But how many know that God is in control?
Mm-hmm.
God allowed this to happen. And there's a reason why this is happening. Okay. And I don't have a full 100% answer for you. But all I can tell you is just be ready. Be ready when God calls you home. Be ready when God calls your number. Because we don't know when God is going to call us. But this, for me, is something I see God, we're living it out. We read about it all in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and when Jesus was walking the earth, he told his disciples that these things shall come, but not to be bad. Or he said that this is not the end, but it's the
right.
beginning of sorrow.
Beginning
and
of sorrow.
So with that being said, this is just the beginning of sorrow, but it's not the end yet. But I thank God right now that I have a mind, and that's why I want to encourage you all out there, have a mind to serve God. Have a mind to, Lord, anything in me that's not like you, take it out, God, because even when this is over, God, I know we sing the song, there shall be glory after this, so even when it's over, God, I still want to be found serving you, God.
Amen.
I still want to be found giving you the praise and the glory, God. I still want to be found different, not the same person. You know, we all, whether we've been saved all our lives or not, we all should come back better, praise God. We all should be better after this, praise God. We should be getting better, glory
to
God.
That's right.
Kind of to go back a little bit, I found a scripture that in Proverbs 14:29 says that whoever is slow to anger has great understanding.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to read that one more time. Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding.
All right.
But he who has a hasty temper exalts folly. So what that means for me is that during this pandemic time, people may have been more emotional or kind of been upset because of the way the pandemic is going, because things are closed, their businesses are closed, schools
mm-hmm.
are closed,
and
so they have to be at home with their children.
Right.
It can cause anger. It can cause, you know, kind of like, it's serious, you
mm-hmm.
know? People are acting different, responding
mm-hmm.
different, but when it says that we have an understanding, you can't be angry. So me personally, I'm not angry because I know why it's happening,
mm-hmm.
because I took the time to read the Bible and
mm-hmm.
to pray and ask God, okay, but his answer is you need to be doing your assignment now.
Yeah,
we can't let the things that are going on outside of us
mm-hmm.
Determine who we are in God.
Yeah.
We have to still keep pushing and realize that, okay, God is telling us something through this, so what am I supposed to be doing about it?
Mm-hmm.
And then on the other half of it, he who is a hasty temper exalts folly. So if we're going to sit around and be angry and not fully want to have an understanding, then we're going to forever be stuck, right?
Right, right.
So I just thought that was something that was key, that that shows that the difference between relationship and rejection.
All right.
So
I like
if you're not willing to take the extra step to ask God why things are happening in our lives, because then you're going to miss your blessing. You're going to miss your assignment.
Wisely, you know, how did you view God before the pandemic as opposed to how do you view him now? I'm thinking of people who have spiritual gifts, and we're going to delve into spiritual gifts tonight a little bit later and really get some extrapolation out of that understanding about spiritual gifts. But right now, there are people who God has exponentially graced you with spiritual gifts. And prior to the pandemic, most folks refuse to allow themselves to be used by God.
Right.
For whatever reason. Most people could have been getting used and decided they're not going to go back and be used again. And whether it's from being, you know, burned out from overuse, or whether it's from having an ego trip because you're underused, or whether it's from church hurt because somebody hurt your feelings one day, this is the time now to understand this about spiritual gifts.
Uh-huh.
First and foremost, if you have gifts or talents, God didn't just give it to you so that you can look like a wonderful person.
Right.
He gave it to you so that he personally could get some glory out of your story. And that's why it's so important to understand where you stand with the Lord.
Yes.
And it's just like being on your job. Every year, for people who have a little bit of continuity and stability on the job, every year or every 6 months, they give you an annual review or a semi-annual review. They're coming in to see just how valuable you are in this company, whether or not we still need you, whether or not you get a demotion or a promotion. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How valuable are you for the purposes of our company? So I say that this is like a good opportunity now for self-evaluation,
yeah.
Particularly to those people who have spiritual gifts,
uh-huh.
Particularly those people who have gifts in the area of technology, and all of these churches out here that are not advanced enough in technology because there's nobody in the church to do it. You could be using your spiritual gifts and talents in somebody's church or somebody's temple or somebody's
yeah.
place of worship, and God could be getting some glory out of the stuff that he put in your hands to do.
Yeah.
And that's what's so important here tonight. God didn't give you gifts to go and sit down or sit down and act like you're so wonderful because you got a gift.
Mm-hmm.
Every good and perfect gift, according to the word of God, came from up above.
Yeah.
That means if you even have a gift to talk about,
mm-hmm.
particularly one that you have developed,
mm-hmm.
that is causing you to put food on the table, then you ought to find a way to give back to God through that gift.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's how it works. And we're going to talk about gifts in detail tonight because I think it's important for the kingdom of God and those of us who are being used in places of worship that we understand the purpose of
yeah.
our gift. We're not going to get too deep in the gift itself, but just the purpose of having the gift.
Yeah.
We'll come back another time and deal with, you know, the actual gifts because there's so many. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Question number two. If you were to die tonight and God was to ask you, why should I allow you to enter into heaven, what would your answer be? That question is deep, but yet simple. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to try to figure that out. Either you're living right or you're not living right. But it is a conversation to ask. It is a conversation to have amongst family members and amongst your friends. If I were to die tonight, where would I go? Because death is real. And it's more real right now with COVID-19.
Amen.
And so we got to know that we're right. Because when I die, I want to know that somebody, whoever does my eulogy, will know that I was saved. Amen. And they won't know, But I would hope by the life that I live that they can say that I was a saved woman of God. And I'm saying all of that to say that it's time that we ask ourselves the question, are we right with God? Whose side are we on? Because the time is winding up, saints of God. Time is winding up. Like they used to sing, payday is coming.
Coming after
a while. And so time is winding up. And there was a scripture
And I didn't want to miss the scripture because I think it goes great with this, because we understand God as being a just, our merciful God, a loving and caring God. But at the end of the day, when he calls us home, he is judgment God. And we have to give an account for everything that we've done in this life. And one of the scriptures over in Revelation 22 and 11 states, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. Meaning that you can't go back. It's too late. Once he's called you, you either in these, either you're filthy or you're unrighteous, or you're righteous and you're holy, praise God. But whatever it is, it's just gonna be still, because there's no changing after that. And so this is not to scare you, but this is to prick your heart tonight, to make you start thinking about, where am I right now with God? What does this really mean to live saved and sanctified? Because sometimes we miss it. You know, sometimes we feel like we can just do everything as long as we go to church, as long as we pay our tithes. But
right.
Brothers and sisters, no, we got to live more saved 24/7. Amen. Right. 365 days out of the year.
That's
we
right.
got to live right for God. Because if we could do anything, then what's the point of Jesus? What's the point of all of this? Us having Bible study, us sharing, if we can live like we want to live. No, there is a standard. Hallelujah. Holiness is a standard. Glory to God. Holiness is a lifestyle, and God is calling us to live for him. And the way we live from him is through the instructions through the Bible. The Bible is what? Believers' instructions before leaving earth. Praise God.
Amen. Amen. If you were to die tonight and ask God why he should allow you into heaven, what would your answer be? In Mark chapter number 3, chapter 3 of St. Mark, it says, and if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. Verse 25 says, and if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. That's synonymous of what we call in the scripture a double-minded man or a double-minded person, unable to control themselves or unable to repent after making a mistake. And so I want to stand right there just for a moment.
All right.
Why would God allow me in? That would be a long answer, but I'm going to give you the condensed version tonight, because I would say, well, first and foremost, I believe in Romans 10:9-10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth that Jesus Christ and believe that God raised him from the dead, if I can do that, if I can make that pursuit verbally to him, and then it's more than just verbally, you know, telling God that he's my savior. If I make a mistake, I can take ownership of that mistake and do like King David did, repent of it.
Uh-huh.
Because this whole Bible is about a story of redemption. That's why I don't see what's so bad about people wanting or not wanting to forgive others. When the Bible clearly says in Hebrews 12:14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Our very ability to get to heaven depends on whether or not we can forgive.
Uh-huh.
And it also depends on whether or not you treat your neighbor as you treat yourself.
Yeah.
Because in order to get to God, in order to get to heaven, you have to become a person of love.
Uh-huh.
And that's why we always say that cliche, God is love.
Yeah.
But we don't really understand what that means.
Yeah.
That means when somebody ticks you off, you still have the ability to forgive them. When somebody grabs your name and runs it through the streets, you still have the ability to forgive them. And in the midst of all of that, even during hardships,
uh-huh,
and times of darkness, you have the ability to stay obedient to God, because obedience is the currency,
uh-huh,
that gets God's attention. That's why it teaches us in Isaiah 1:19, if ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. So you have to be very cognizant of where you stand in your pursuit of God.
Yeah.
Which is why what you're going through right now on an individual level, whether you want to agree or not, is an actual interview,
mm-hmm,
with our Father in heaven and our big brother Jesus and our covering and protector Holy Spirit. What you're going through right now is an interview. God wants to know, where do you stand?
Yes.
Because you're waking up every day, and for those who are fortunate and blessed enough to work remotely, you got it going on. But there's somebody next door to you that doesn't have a paycheck coming in.
Uh-huh.
There's do the things that we do.
Yes.
And then there are other people who are forced to trust in God for money to keep coming in.
Yes.
In some way, shape, form, or fashion. Most people tend to look at this as what we call natural warfare, and they're only focused on just the COVID-19 situation. Mm-hmm. But the people of God who are intellectual enough in our understanding on a spiritual level know that this is absolute spiritual warfare.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's taking place right now. So the Bible is teaching us about God in a fresh new way.
Yeah.
And we can't just, you know, think that these are just some little stories to hear to entertain us.
Come on.
It teaches us about the goodness of God.
Yeah.
But it also teaches us about the failures of man.
Uh-huh.
And even in all of this, it is not God who has failed. Amen?
Amen.
But it is mankind, those of us in the human race, who have failed him.
Uh-huh.
But as I said before, this is a story about redemption. Mm-hmm. Because even when the people of God were troubled in various parables and various stories across the Bible, they always prayed. And then they did something that was absolutely necessary. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they did what I call the 1-2 punch of spiritual faith. They fasted and they prayed. Because the Bible says some things will come out by prayer. But there are some things that will only, somebody say only.
Only.
There are some things that will only come out by the combination of fasting and prayer. This is your opportunity to regurgitate all of the stuff that you've learned about God, to be reinvigorated down in your spirit about all the stuff that you learned about, to be reinforced now in your spiritual understanding that you might cultivate a fresh new relationship with God.
Yes.
Because you need the power of his anointing. Mm-hmm. In order to be successful in a season such as this.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So do you feel that it's time to be used by God? And I know that we've hit on that tonight, and this is definitely a time to be used by God. And so may you have something you want to say on, is this time to be used by God? It's our time.
Yeah, I think it's like past time to be used by God.
Hello.
Because that we can't necessarily wait for a pandemic or something big to happen to say, okay, now I think it's my time to be used by God. Even though, unfortunately, sometimes it does happen like that, because not everyone comes to the understanding when they're supposed to or when they should. Mm-hmm. But it's still, I think it's still a good way to shift our minds. Okay, what is God asking me? So it is time to be used by God. But what does that look like? How are we going to be used by God? We have to be willing and obedient. We can't be used by God if we're not going to, you know, be fully part of him.
Right.
So another scripture that I found is Proverbs 18:2. A fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. Mm-hmm. So when we don't have an understanding, we're quick to think that we know the answer to what God is trying to tell us, or the answer for ourselves, when that's not the case. We have to be able to listen to what God is saying to us, because what is our assignment? What does it mean and look like to be used by God?
Yeah.
That means that if God gives an assignment, or if we're supposed to be doing something involved in ministry, or even outside of ministry, still being used by God.
Yeah.
Making sure, and what for me, what being used by God looks like is taking other people who don't know who God is and being able to help them understand who God is. Yeah. For their life. If I can't do that, I can't be able to be used by God if I don't have the proper understanding or willingness to take that extra step and pray to God and understand what his word is saying.
Mm-hmm.
Because God speaks to everyone individually in his own way. He's not going to tell me the same thing that he tells her,
right.
Vice versa, right?
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
So another scripture says, the unfolding of your words gives light. It imparts understanding to the simple. That's Psalm 119 and 130.
Mm-hmm.
So the unfolding of your words gives light. So just by God speaking a word over us and what he's found in the Bible, that is giving us light. But what does that light mean? That's the assignment, right? That's me being used by God. Because I'm seeing his light. How do I share the light with someone else?
Right.
Mm-hmm. It imparts understanding to the simple. So once we're able to realize that and come to an understanding, then it becomes simple, you know?
Mm-hmm.
What his word says it's not going to be simple right off if you don't have a fresh understanding. But if you take time to really dig deep into what the word is saying, then it becomes even more simple. Mm-hmm. And it gets simpler and simpler and simpler.
Amen.
Prayer life, that becomes easier and easier and easier because at first I didn't know how to pray. And I'm still working on certain areas, but I have a better understanding and a better prayer life because of me being able to have parents that know how to pray and teach me how to pray, and also taking the time to develop my own prayer life and what works for me.
Right.
So it's just about taking time to realize what works for you, but what also works for God and what He's telling you to do.
That's good.
So
that's awesome. That's good. I like that. Yeah. Lord.
Do you feel that it's time to be used by God? This is a two-part question because part one says, do you understand your spiritual gift? Let's deal with that just for a moment. And I'm going to go from 5 years of being a pastor and understanding how people are when it comes to gifts. I've seen people come through the church, and if you don't pay them the money that they're looking for, they're gone. I've seen people come through the church, and if you don't use them the way they want to be used, when they say they want to be used, they're gone. I've seen other people, the only time they show up is when it's their assignment to do a thing or participate with the program. And like some singers, the ability to sing does not necessarily make you anointed.
Right.
We see people all over the world who are R&B singers, and you realize that they're not really anointed when they try to sing a gospel song because there's nothing there for you to connect to. There are some people who try to preach and teach or run a business or, you know, be great employees on your job. If you don't have the right connection with God, you're not going to be successful in any of your endeavors. That's why you have to understand your spiritual gifts. And then you have to understand how that gift transcends across social platforms, professional platforms, and every other platform that's out there. Because God didn't give you a gift just for you to sit down and look cute to say, oh, I got a gift.
Right.
I'm all of that.
Right.
I don't have to come to practice because I'm gifted. You might be gifted, but you might not be anointed. So you have to be very careful with your gifts. Part two of this question for me is, are you willing to allow your gift to be cultivated and then used by God in ministry? And this is what so many people claim to have church hurt, but what it really is just a hurt feeling or a busted ego. You're not really hurt. You didn't follow the rules, or you didn't go through the normal procedure to get to where you were trying to go, or you refused to sit down and let somebody train you, cultivate you, and develop the gift that God placed inside of you. And so there's a lot of times where the pastor doesn't want you to look like a hot mess because he is focused on having excellence. So God will put you in the midst of people who have your best interest at heart, and it's kind of like what I try to do or have done. I never put a person in a position where they can fail.
Mm-hmm.
We put them in a position where they can be guided, where they can be grown, where they can be developed, where they can be nurtured. And then at some point, you're not going to get the position unless you're already doing the job.
Right.
We're not going to put you into an auto mechanic shop and you studied to be a doctor. That's a misnomer. We're going to put you in a place where we see you leaning, or we see you going in that direction. And I read a quote this morning from Bishop George Bloomer that said, your assignment will always be greater than your situation.
Yeah.
When God allows you to pass through a storm, it is because He is preparing you for a great assignment, which only you can do.
Yeah.
But you can miss that assignment by letting your feelings get in the way.
Mm.
You can miss your assignment by letting your ego cause you to trip.
Mm-hmm.
You can miss your assignment if you're not willing to forgive somebody for a little, small, minute, minuscule misunderstanding.
Mm-hmm.
Romans 12 says it like this in verses number 6 through 8. Having then gifts, differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth, on teaching, or he that exhorteth, on exhortation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. Don't try to shine shine when the light is not on you. In other words, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. In other words, walk through this thing with a lowliness and an humbleness that will cause you to be successful. I learned that a long time ago. If the light is not on you, stop trying to shine. Stop trying to be the superstar. I learned this from a mega church. You're not the featured person anyhow.
Right.
Even the man or woman who pastors the church is not the featured person anyhow. At all times, Jesus is the star of the show. There's only one. No one else can replace him. Why else would we say that no one else born of a woman walked the face of the earth and never once sinned? That makes him special.
That's right.
And he's an all-forgiving, all-loving, unconditionally loving God. And that's why King David, with all of his trouble, was the only man ever called a man after God's own heart. Because he knew how to repent.
Yes.
He knew how to walk this thing out. And I'll tell you like this, for those of you who are looking for that limelight, the best sermon that you will ever preach is going to be with your feet. Because people want to see how you're going to walk this thing out, how you're going to act. Since you're supposed to be a Christian and all, how are you going to act when you lose your job? How are you going to act when you have to go through a divorce? How are you going to act when all hell breaks loose in your life? How are you going to act when the stuff that you saw somebody else go through and break down and cry and lose their mind and almost have a nervous breakdown, how are you going to respond if that same thing comes and knocks on your door?
Yes.
Will you send your faith to answer or your emotions?
Faith to answer.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You got to, we've got to all learn how to put our faith on our family.
Yes.
We got to take the favor of God through the faith that he puts on the inside of us and place that on the famine. We're living in a time of a famine right now. That's why it's important to know, where did you stand? And in order to understand where you stand, you have to also know who God is in your life.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And allow God to use you that the body of Christ might be blessed.
Yes. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus.
It's important.
Thank you, Father God.
It's important that you understand who you are.
Yeah.
Because your best day with the devil is still no match for your worst day with God.
My God.
It's no match.
No match.
There's nothing that the enemy can do for you that God hasn't already done or won't do for you at some point in time. But you have to develop a closeness with him, a relationship with him that causes him to know that you are serious.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible says in Matthew 19:26, for this is not possible with man, but it's still possible with God.
Yeah.
Luke 1:37 says, there is nothing impossible for God, but it is still incumbent upon us and very intrinsically in our behavior that we have to hold on and know that we can trust in God, to know that we can depend on God.
Yeah.
And that's why 1 Corinthians 15:58 says it this way, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. And you have to understand that your work in the Lord is not in vain. And while you are waiting on the Lord, be working with the Lord.
Yeah.
That's why it's important to understand your spiritual gifts and your talents. Don't sit on your talent. Don't sit on your gift when the body of Christ could utilize it for the glory of God.
Yeah.
Somebody might come to church and hear you say one word and change their life.
That's right.
Shift. Somebody might come to church, hear you play a song on an instrument, and shift. Somebody might come and hear you preach, and shift.
Yeah.
Somebody might come on that special day, which we call testimony service, and hear you talk about something that you went through, talk about how God did it for you, how he turned it all around for you, and it caused somebody to shift.
Yeah.
There's a shifting going on, and somebody needs to catch the wave tonight.
Yeah.
Where do you stand with the Lord?
Yeah. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you want to understand your spiritual gifts, you can contact us at saveandserving.org and send us information on our contact us page.
Yeah.
You can also send us an email at information@saveandserving.org. You can also place your comments down here, either on the YouTube channel or on the Facebook MW January Ministries Facebook page, and we can record your information if you're looking to understand your spiritual gifts.
Mm-hmm.
We have actual tests that are available, and they're made available on the internet. It's just public stuff, but we have the actual test as well. If you would like to have a copy of it, or if you wanted to know what your spiritual gifts are, before you try to say, I'm gifted in this area or that area, it's like anything else. You take an examination to see just how gifted or not gifted you are. You know, that's going to dispel the myth as to whether or not you have a gift at all. So contact us if you would like to obtain these tests. There is a separate test for adults and for youth, because we want the people of God to have an intellectual relationship, being able to understand what's going on in these spiritual gifts and dealing with all of these talents. You don't just get up on the stage and start singing. You don't just get up on the rostrum and start preaching. You don't just come to Sunday school class or Wednesday night Bible class and start talking and teaching because you think, you know, you got it going on, or because somebody told you you're going to be a preacher one day. And somebody else might have told you you're going to be a millionaire one day and you can't even pay your bills. So let's not just be so quick and so zealous when because somebody else told you something. What is God saying to you? The beauty of all of this is God can talk to us one-on-one. And this is no throw off on the Jews, but we don't need a priest to talk to God. You can talk to God one-on-one. And when you develop the right relationship with him, he'll talk back to you. Amen. And he'll make it clear as it needs to be. Amen?
Amen.
Because that's the kind of God we serve.
Man, I think Miguel has something you want to say something about. I was looking at the part two. Are you willing to allow your gift to be cultivated and then used by God in ministry?
Right.
And so the word that kept running through my head when I read this was marinate.
Right.
And it's just like, when we're in school and we have a test that our teacher is preparing us for, we have a few days, normally like, a week to study to then take that test, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this isn't the same thing. We can't think that we hear something from God and telling us that we need to fulfill an assignment, think that it's going to happen just like that. We need time to sit and marinate in God's word and
mm-hmm.
also sit there and develop a prayer life. But the marination comes from understanding what God's word is saying and living it.
Mm-hmm.
So letting it soak in us and make sure that we have a full understanding, because we can't do something or fulfill an assignment if we don't have full understanding for ourselves.
Yeah.
But then also on the other half of that, if I want to be cultivated and then used by God in ministry, what comes with that? It's not just me wanting out being ministered, but there's greater things that are behind that.
Mm-hmm.
So Proverbs 3:13-18 says, blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gives understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, and her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. So the greatest outcome that we can get from God is peace. And this only comes from letting go of the disturbance, if that
mm-hmm.
makes sense. We can't always let go of the disturbance, but what we can do is develop a relationship with God, and he will take it away from us.
Yeah.
So yes, the enemy, especially us Christians and the people who are for God, get attacked the most, so there
mm-hmm.
is always still going to be the devil trying to trick us, but how are we going to respond? What is the greater outcome?
Yeah.
So you have the biggest blessing when you're on God's side, because he does not promise you anything that he won't fulfill.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to meet him halfway and fulfill his assignment, then he is going to bless you regardless and bless you tremendously in different ways. But we have to be willing and obedient in order for that to happen and take place.
Yeah.
But I think that it has everything to do with our gifts, because God gave us each our own individual gifts for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't really determine what your own gift is. You can think about what your gift is.
Mm-hmm.
You might have an estimate or a guess, but you won't fully know until you ask trust God yourself, but that's also, you know, trying to be wholesome. Mm-hmm. So I might think that my gift is something else because I don't want to fully come under subjection and ask God, okay, what is my sign? What am I supposed to be doing? Yeah. But once we're able to fully walk with God and say, okay, I'm willing and obedient, God, my arms are open to you. What is God going to say back to us is what the real question is.
All right.
What answer am I looking for God to give me? What should I be asking God?
Mm-hmm.
What does he want me to do? We have to stop thinking about ourselves and thinking more about, okay, it's not about us. It is about the kingdom of God. So, yeah, that word marinate. We have to let the word sit in us. We can't just take something and run with it unless we have a full understanding. But that takes time.
It's time to develop.
So as we begin to wrap up here, I wanna grab a hold of something that she just said. She said, I might think my gift is one thing because I don't want to bring myself under the subjection of God.
Mm-hmm.
We've heard stories and we've seen proof and evidence of people who go out and have the gift of administration but try to pastor.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen other people who have the gift to sing spend more time on the usher board, you know. We've seen people displaced or misplaced for whatever reason.
Right.
And a lot of it has to do with your personal relationship, your personal walk with the Lord. For many years, people told my grandfather, because he was a deacon in the church, you're going to be a preacher one day. I see you as a preacher. And I'll never forget it. Because every time somebody said that to my grandfather, and then one man had the nerve enough to come up and say, God told me you're going to be a preacher. My grandfather said, no, he didn't, because he didn't tell me. I'll never forget it. And that simply is a lesson for me to remember. It doesn't matter who says, I see you as a preacher. I see you as a singer. I see you as this or that. It only matters if God says it to you. It only matters if it's prophesied through a man or woman of God to you.
Right.
And then God, he never gives us something, as I like to say, fresh off the boat without giving you a confirmation.
Right.
He's always going to give you something that is a confirmation that, of something that's already in your spirit.
Right.
That's why it's important to understand your personal walk with the Lord. So the Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered. But I'm just coming to remind you, you got to be willing to move your feet. In other words, instead of just sitting back waiting for somebody to tell you something, get on your knees. Always checking your email. Give God some knee mail. Hallelujah. Give God some knee mail so that you can get the download that is coming from heaven.
Yeah.
Once you get the download, people can say anything they want to you. And you will say like my grandfather, God didn't tell me, so it must not be true. If God shows it to you, he's going to confirm it. He's not going to bring you something fresh off the boat. It's going to be something that's already in your spirit. Because from that email, he's going to give you a download, causing your spirit to be in sync with his spirit. And when the person prophesies, they're not telling you anything new. They're just confirming what God has already said. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So we thank God for the word tonight.
Yes, thank the Lord.
And we hope that someone has been blessed tonight. And once again, if you would like a copy of the Adult and You Spiritual Gifting Test, please place your email address in the comment section or send us an actual email to information@savedandserving.org or go to our website, www.savedandserving.org, and click on the Contact Us and send us your information. Right now, I just want to take a second that if anyone has decided that tonight is your night and you want to give your life to the Lord, I want you to understand something. That the Bible says in Romans 10:9-10, that if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus with thy mouth and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart, man believeth, and with the mouth, confession is made. Amen? So just repeat after me, if you're looking for God to do something marvelous in your life because you want him to be your one and only Lord and Savior. Say this with me. Father in heaven.
Father in heaven.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
That he died on the cross for me.
That he died on the cross for me.
I receive him now.
I receive him now.
Into my heart.
Into my heart.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
And I'm saved.
And I'm saved.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
If you recited that simple little prayer with me, Your name is now written into the book of life.
Yes.
We want you to let us know. Send us some information. Contact us. Let us know that you have given your life over to the Lord. And according to Luke 15 and 7, there's a party going on right now. And it's got your name on it. And it's going on in heaven. Amen. Go read that verse, Luke 15 and 7, to see what God is doing for you right now up in heaven.
Yes, yes, yes.
God bless you and God keep you. My beautiful wife, Lady January, is going to take us out of here with a word of prayer. Be blessed.
Thank you. Father God, we just thank you right now, God. We thank you. The scripture says, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Father God, we pray, oh God, that we're not trying to profit in ourselves, oh God, but we want to profit in you, oh God, so that when you call us home, God, we know where we stand, God, and that we are on your side, oh God. Father God, I pray for that soul, oh God, who listened to us all evening long, oh God. Father God, that you would deal with their hearts and their minds, oh God, that you would give them a mind to grow, God. Give them a mind to be better, God. I pray in the name of Jesus, oh God. And Father God, as we now leave this place, but not your presence, oh God, cover us in your blood, God. Give us sweatless victories all week long, oh God. Have your way, I pray, in the name of Jesus, oh God. We thank you and we give your name praise. I pray for sweet rest for that person who can't sleep at night. I pray that God will give you peace of mind tonight, that you would have a restful sleep on tonight. In the name of Jesus, I thank God.